representation, and some of our film makers are on their way, and some of our panelists who are at work are on their way. So it's a flexible evening. Relax. As our program says, we'll start off with our keynote, who is at the back drinking coffee. And then we'll move into our first film, hopefully our Q&A. And then our second film and a panel discussion, and then a performance. So I'd like to welcome you to this event called Performing Diaspora. Performing Diaspora started 4 years ago, and it grows out of a need to think about the African diaspora in its most complex ways. There is often a way in which we think about the diaspora in an academic setting like this only in terms of the things that we read, right? Age 35, 35? But we need to think about the diaspora in the way in which it sees itself and the way in which it expresses itself. And over the last 4 years, we've thought that maybe the way in which the diaspora performs itself and imagines itself and produces and reproduces itself is another important way to think about the persons of African descent wherever they might be found. In the first year, Performing Diaspora focused on jazz. In the second year, on drumming. In the third year, or other way around, on gospel singing and spirituals. And this year we thought, why not film? Let's think about how people represent themselves and are represented in this very important medium. To get us on the right track, we're going to invite Professor Pablo Idahosa, who is currently the Graduate Director of Development Studies and former Director of African Studies. And anybody who's at York thinks African Studies, they think Pablo. It's not complicated. He teaches a course about African popular culture, and he's the author of The Populist Dimension of African Political Thought and co-editor of the Somali Diaspora. Among his current projects, he's working on nationalism and development and a book about popular culture and development. But before Pablo joins us to take us on his journey and what he thinks, how we'd like to frame our thoughts this evening, I just want to remind everyone that this is not just an event, but it is also an academic exercise. We're going to be filming the panelists, we're going to be filming the questions, we're going to be thinking these things through, and later on we're going to be transcribing and storing for posterity this part of our own history, because we are in the process of making history. It will later be edited for a publication, and you will be part of that event. So thank you for joining us this evening, and I welcome Pablo to the podium, especially since he's not feeling so well. Thank you, Pablo.
One of the pleasures that I have about being at York is that I get to go get older while the people I teach to remain the same age. It's one of the wonderful dilemmas about getting older is that everyone in front of you is more or less the same age. And one of the things I always benefit from in a sense, there's a wonderful Edo expression, which is that children make you old and keep you young. Making old is, of course, kids, they're difficult, right? And they make you old. The keeping young part is that they keep you in touch with what's going on. So one of the things about diaspora, forming diaspora, or representing diaspora, is the need to stay in touch, the need to be constantly aware of the changes that are we're currently and always undergoing as a community, as a society, as different populations. And I'm struck about when, for example, I put music to my class. I also am an adjunct professor in the music department. It's just how quickly they're distant from music that I used to play, let's say, 5 years ago. And yet, what's interesting is a lot of the popular musicians that we might get to talk about or represent speak to similar issues, even though there are different times that the students are a part of. And although I'm not going to strictly speak in the short time I have about film, I am going to kind of represent through music, again, around the nature of diaspora. And it's no accident that this particular session is about the griot. For those who don't know, griot is really a praising, someone who praises people of stature and authority in their given societies, particularly from the Mandé tradition in West Africa and places like Mali, which as many of you know is undergoing major problems today. Senegal, Gambia, Cote d'Ivoire, Burkina Faso, the main areas where these people come from. And their tradition is 1,000 years old. It's actually over 1,000 years old. And what's interesting about it is there is a form of music today called Mandingo rap, Malinke rap, which is about looking at the older traditions, but at the same time, bring them in to rap music. And they represent a lot of the, and I'd ask you to go on YouTube and quickly, if you've got your phones, to go and look at some of the current artists. I'm not going to represent them today. What I really wanted to do was to give you three quick representations, in a sense, of diaspora, but also performing diaspora, and how diaspora is represented through those different ways of representation. And one, and I'm going to play a bit of music, and I'm going to put up some the lyrics for this song, so that you get to see where they're at. This is a South African reggae artist who unfortunately was murdered in South Africa a number of years ago, and was arguably one of the world's most famous reggae artists. Now what's interesting about this is twofold. One, it represents a return of the diaspora to Africa, right, in the musical form, where reggae is so popular throughout, less so dancehall, I have to say, although many parts of Africa have their own forms of dancehall. But certainly reggae is enormously popular and has fused back into many of the musics of different parts of Africa. And I just want to briefly play a little bit of this, and I'm going to put the words up. But we can't play a little bit because I don't have enough time. But I do want you to... identity in the issue of diaspora amongst a great many people in the diaspora, for obvious reasons, because of the nature of slavery. I'm just going to move on a little bit further, very quickly, and go down to Performing Diaspora is to understand the role of the various people who represent. In this instance, it's musicians. In this instance, it's popular musicians. And popular musicians have an enormous amount of authority and power once they get to the point, of course, of having the ability to communicate with thousands of people. And in some cases, they're like millions of people. If you don't get a record deal, then you can't do it. Right? So having that power implies that, of course, you're commercialized. In other words, that you have the ability to speak to thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands, if you're really lucky, millions of people. Now, if any of you watched the Super Bowl last night, which I did, you would have seen two people of African descent there, Beyonce and Alicia Keys, right? And they did two very different things. One, Beyonce did her thing. It was all, you know, mega Super Bowl stuff, which is not about to be embedded in, to be part of, or for that matter, to be in some ways central to the understanding of the values of the community. Alicia Keys did the American nationalism bit and sang the national anthem beautifully, as long as she did, and so on. But what I want you to think about is what the role of the griot is, and whether we can say to everyone who does music, who plays music, or who performs music, plays that role. There are some people who perform the role of a musician who, in fact, in many ways we could argue or claim, are really reproducing a certain way of understanding diaspora, right? Which is about performance, which is about the role of performance. In other words, the black people only do performance. Griots are about testing as well as praising. They're about addressing the issues that affect people in their daily lives. They're about addressing the ways in which people understand themselves. They're about addressing sometimes complex things. And one of the geniuses, I think, of a great many popular artists is that ability to distinguish, is that ability to summarize and get complex issues but represent them in a simple way. So you get someone like Lucky Dube. I'm going to play one more piece of music before my time is up, if I can, right? Is that they're able to represent really complex issues, as I say, but in a way that most people can apprehend, that most people can feel and be touched by. I want to play another piece, which is in an African language, but again, it speaks to the same kind of issue.
didn't you come for us? Monsieur, you come for us.
I'm gonna, it's in French and Bambara, I'm gonna get the translation for you. Forget about the woman. And it raises another issue, right? Which I want to address. Ties and vests. They do not tell the truth. But my brothers and sisters, I was dreaming of France. For once here, it is only problems. Without papers, you cannot find work. You cannot do anything without papers. Now I suffer. I can do nothing. I prefer to take my ticket and return to Guinea. There at least I have a trade. There at least I am home. Again, diasporic consciousness. Imagining home from a place that he's left in order to improve himself. There are two things about that video, and this again gets back to the issue of representation. You get the usual, not the usual, but the popular cultural feature of videos, which is about showing a young woman scantily clad, as you say, right? On the other hand, you get the more traditional backdrop of the jolly women, the women who are performing. And once again, you get the two, the modern and the more traditional. And it raises a number of questions, again, about performing. At what level do we perform and get a message across? Is it necessary to have someone in the tradition of rap videos dressed in a certain kind of way at the same time as emphasizing tradition? I say all this in part because I want to reiterate this issue of the degree to which we're able to find people who could speak to the issues that matter to people where they are of African descent. And the means by which, the vehicles through which, the musical vehicles through which we do this. So here are two videos that give illustrations or examples of how Africans in a diaspora, or words I should say in videos, so Africans in a diaspora think about themselves on the one hand, but also try to recreate the worlds that they are part of. But 3 minutes left, I'm going to wait one more, okay? Now, by the way, this is an exercise in a kind of education, because one of the questions I was going to ask, and this is more for the younger people, but I'll embarrass, I know there's a division of labor, most of the older people are sitting over here, I don't know why. But I was going to ask if any of you knew of any of these people at all. Who's heard of Lucky Dube? Okay, some of you have. Who's heard of Foley Barrow? You've heard of Foley Barrow, okay? Can I ask where?
Because I'm around the French.
Okay, all right, but that's a good enough reason. Okay. Now, I'm going to shame you all, because if you don't know who the next person is, you're going to be in trouble. All of you. Okay? Again, part of the diasporic imagination is about imagination, Pan-Africanist imagination of return. And arguably one of the oldest diasporas out of Africa is the people from Cabo Verde off the coast of West Africa. One of the first places where slavery was established before plantation slavery really took off in the so-called New World and the Caribbean. And this is again a song of longing. About returning to a place, it's very difficult to be in because of the problems of drought, the problems of the lack of rains, and when the rain comes, it turns into this burning place. So one of the issues then, it seems to me, that would be interesting for everyone to think about and pursue is not only about the representations of people in the diaspora, but the means by which they represent, the vehicles that they use to represent. And I'm going to suggest three ways in which it's done. One, obviously, is in the broadest Pan-African sense. Okay? Africa in the world. The various diasporas, where they go, and the locations where they are. So whether they're the cities in India, whether they're the Somalis who were took to, and the Ethiopians who were taken, for example, different from Sudan, who were taken to Saudi Arabia. Whether they are, of course, people from the East Indian Ocean as well. As well as, of course, the Atlantic as well. So they're the kind of larger pictures about the nature of representation. The second has to do with what we might call community. Right? Now these things are bounded, and the extent to which they can be translated into different understandings that all people of African descent have. Why do I put it in these terms? Because one, of course, you're dealing with language. And some traditions come specifically out of a given place and location, are bounded by a given type of language. And the third one has to do with the representations of, we might say, of the new diasporas, the people who have been displaced, the people who have been forced in more recent times to find their ways in different places. And it seems to me, if we look at diasporas in these three ways, there are many other ways of looking at diaspora, but if we can look at them in these ways and look at the different ways in which they're represented, but ask the question, for whom are they represented? And I say that, in part because there are multiple diasporas as well as the African diaspora. But it seems to me one of the easiest ways of getting a sense of the tone, the stories, the diaspora is through music, and most especially through popular music. It's there that you get a text, it's there that you get a sense of the meaning of diaspora amongst these different communities. I leave it there. Thank you.